Normally, I think any other band that sang that lyric, "You're my best friend," they, people would throw things at them. They would burn their records, you know, on live on the radio. But what a beautiful song. Just the conviction of doing a simple pop song, well crafted.
All of a sudden, John Deacon emerged from his vows of silence to speak up that he wanted his song out as a single.
He didn't write that many, but you know, if you think about it, "Another One Bites the Dust," "You're My Best Friend," "I Want to Break Free," big, big hits. And "You're My Best Friend" is still one of the most played tracks on American radio.
"You're My Best Friend" was a significant song as far as radio was concerned in the United States. I mean, I think that it was a kind of friendlier, more accessible side to some of the stuff Queen was doing.
John was always a dark horse. He always was. You know, he's the guy who doesn't say very much up to a certain point. I mean, he would go nuts sometimes and say a lot. But generally, he was the quiet guy. And he would come in and we'd say, "Have you got anything, John?" And he'd go, "Oh, well, I've got this. I don't know. You know, I don't know if it's any good, but we could try this." You know, very self-effacing.
I think they encouraged him. The other guys wanted the more to have more of a stake in it, because after all, the songwriting, you know, there's all those extra royalties, and that's often an issue with rock and roll bands, and quite often a reason why some of them break up. So they wanted to make sure. I know Freddie, I mean, even as early as Queen 2, he'd be encouraging John to contribute. And I think John was just a little reticent. He was the last to join, and he was certainly the most shy.
He just writes in that one area which he likes, which is almost like a Tamla Motown or the sort of... And I love that, because I love to sing on songs like that. So he's very different. I mean, you could never call his songs heavy.
It was written on a Fender Rhodes. John played it. John played his own keyboards. And John, as far as I know, wrote the song about his lovely lady wife. Further than that, you would have to ask John. And I don't think he's probably in the mood to answer at this point.
And it's a shame that, you know, he really feels that he doesn't want to be part of the music business these days. I can see his point in some ways, but, you know, he just sort of doesn't really want to... He doesn't like meeting people a lot, and he has opted for the quiet life, although he approves of what we do. And... I said so.
The vocal harmonies, you know, on a Queen record are going to provide it with unity, regardless of what the kind of, you know, individual style of a particular song is. You know, there's something that's, you know, instantly identifiable about what they do.
The three voices that we had blended instantly and sounded very big.
They interacted quite magically, and we all had different qualities in our voices. And I had a sort of high, searing quality. Freddie had an incredibly powerful quality in most ranges. And Brian had a very nice quality in the lower range. And so the three made a very good combination. But what we would do is we would not take a single part each. We would all together sing every part.
So as soon as the three of us sang a line, it already sounded quite big. You double track that, it sounds very big, and then we would sing the next line and the next line and the next line.
So you really were looking after both ends of the sort of spectrum there. In fact, all ends, you know, you were covering everything. So it came out particularly strong. And that was really part of the Queen sound, I think, the fact that the three of us sang every part.
The backing vocals there. Ooh, still come back to you, girl.
I'm happy at home. The skill that they could just build those layers and layers and layers of harmony and make the whole thing work rather than you focus on elements of it and then, you know, forget the rest. That, I think, is really what always was the thing that made them stand out from everybody else.
Well, there was never any question of writing a single. We just wrote albums, and then, you know, so they would really, by consensus, it would be, that sounds like the first single, you know, and then there might be some argument.
Obviously, you have certain of your own babies if you wrote the song, and you want them to be heard in a wide area.
usually the writer of that particular Red song would be arguing that he should have the single.
And if you miss that opportunity, it's kind of gone forever. In my case, I think we all had things like that that we felt sad about. In my case, there's things like Long Away, 39 of this album, you know, which could have been a single, and part of me wishes they had been, because they would have been much more in the public consciousness. You know, songs become hooked into people's lives in a very wonderful way. You know, you hear a song and it reminds you of being on a beach somewhere at a particular time with a particular person. And if the song hasn't become a single, it doesn't have that opportunity to become part of life.